This video was made possible through the support of my patrons.
The most precious thing on this earth is the human brain, and yet we allow it to die.
It is quite useless to resist, as we are stronger and more efficient than your earth people.
You belong to us. You shall be like us.
The ascension shall begin.
The strength and might of the cyber race will be confirmed.
Pain. I am Vanguard. Pain. Pain.
Pain. 2010 was the beginning of a new regime change at Doctor Who. Stephen Moffat was the showrunner, Matt Smith was the new Doctor, and we also had new producers and creatives behind the scenes. With the show's popularity at an all-time high during this transition, there were attempts to capitalise and branch out the mediums that Doctor Who was telling stories in. We've already talked about stage shows, comic books, audio dramas and webcasts during this marathon, but now, it's time to talk about video games. When Series 5 dropped, the BBC outsourced the development of a series of PC games to studio Sumo Digital, who gave us 5 episodes over a 16-month period, which saw the 11th Doctor, voiced by Matt Smith, and companion Amy Pond, voiced by Karen Gillan, facing the Daleks, getting lost in the TARDIS, and encountering the Vashta Narada, with Third Wheel Rory Williams, voiced by Arthur Darvill, joining for a visit to the Gunpowder Plot in the 17th century, where they encountered the Sontarans and the Rutans. However, the game that we'll be talking about today is the second release, Blood of the Cybermen, where the Doctor and Amy get a distress signal, leading them to an Arctic survey team who have discovered the long-buried remains of the Cybermen in the ice. However, their Cybermats are still active, which start converting the team into cyberslaves to do their bidding and help to wake up the Cyber Army. It's up to the Doctor and Amy to cure the base team of their cyber conditioning and prevent the return of the Cybermen. Now, last year for Dalekcember, I covered their adventure game City of the Daleks, but only in passing when discussing their cameos, and I was planning to do the same thing here, but then I realised that I needed to pad out some of the days in this month to reach 25 videos. So, you know what I was going to do? I was going to waltz into this video and be super smart and big brain and say, hey folks, this game, it's like John Carpenter's The Thing, but with Cybermen. And the comments were going to be like, oh, Mr. TARDIS, oh, you're so clever, oh, like and subscribe. But then...
Doctor, did you ever see The Thing?
The Carpenter Kurt Russell thing or the Howard Hawks thingy with the walking carrot?
Huh. An entire day's review content. Months of planning. Down the drain. Now I know how Jared Yates Sexton felt. I worked on this review for a year, and they just blurted it out. Okay, so those plans may be scuppered, but I'm in way too deep now. Let's just break down the basics of Blood of the Cybermen. What you've got here is your basic third-person puzzle platformer. You frequently swap between playing as the 11th Doctor and Amy Pond to complete basic puzzles, which mainly amount to short brain teasers, like wiring devices to the TARDIS, hacking into computers, moving mirrors to reflect lasers, etc. Gameplay-wise, it's pretty straightforward, with some basic platforming as well, though some of these segments can be pretty slow when you have to wait for these ice blocks to move into place before you can cross. It's not exactly the high-octane action-packed adventuring you'd normally find in Series 5. Speaking of energy, and I hate to be that guy, but there is one thing about these adventure games across the board that really does let the side down, and that is Matt Smith. His Doctor is usually so high energy and fun and bouncing off the walls, but put him in front of a microphone for these games, and...
He could never get his fingers around G-sharp.
You're actually telling me you taught Elvis to play guitar?
Well, not very well, obviously. How long's that been flashing?
Search me, what is it?
Someone's sending an SOS.
Now, I've no interest in trying to be mean or harsh, but there's clearly a massive discrepancy between Matt Smith on screen and Matt Smith in these adventure games.
A living mental image and a living human mind. We stare at them to stop them getting closer. We don't even blink. And that is exactly what they want, because as long as our eyes are open, they can climb inside. There's an angel in her mind.
I repaired the great Klaxion generators of Thrart. I got the ionic flux engines of the Dragadorf Imperial flagship running with an old chewing gum wrapper and a mouse trap. I think I can fix a sat-nav.
And this isn't me trying to be harsh. Heck, I'm hardly a voice actor at all. My background was in theatre, and I probably sound monotone when I'm put in front of a microphone. It's completely different aspects of performances. Matt Smith is clearly a very physical actor. On the other hand, though, you have Karen Gillan, who does a much better job overall. And the rest of the cast are pretty good as well, with Barnaby Edwards playing Chisholm and Sarah Douglas as Professor Meadows, with, of course, Nicholas Briggs returning to voice the Cybermen. In terms of this game's place in universe, its biggest contribution is the return of the Cybermats, who hadn't appeared on TV at least for 35 years. With designs that harken back to Revenge of the Cybermen, these Cybermats are able to infect humans with some sort of poison, which turns them into cyberslaves, which are basically just mindless drones, the bodies of humans but the heads, the helmets at least, of Cybermen. However, at one point, we do get to see Chisholm partially converted, and it's surprisingly pretty gruesome. Also, Amy is a freaking monster in this game. She's a killing machine. She takes down several cyberslaves on her own, but still manages to wind up kidnapped and held hostage at the end.
That's a cyber conversion chamber. Don't you dare touch her.
Then comply with my demand.
Which is?
This ship was caught in a temporal storm and crashed. The cryo systems are too badly damaged for us to repair, to reanimate my cyber brethren. But you, Doctor, you have the genius of a Time Lord.
You want me to wake a Cyberman invasion of Earth? You're mad.
It is your choice, Doctor. Wake them, or your companion becomes the first of a new line of Cybermen.
All right, I'll do it.
You want to do another take of that line, Matt? The stealth is pretty rudimentary. Walk around, avoid the Cybermen and the cyber drones, and avoid that green triangle field of vision so you don't die. However, despite this game and its predecessors teaching you to not step in those green zones under any circumstances, in order to progress at one point, you need to step in one and use your sonic screwdriver against a Cybermat. That's just bad design.
Right, Amy, press the button!
I'll take this lift next, Doctor!
Whoa, why are you shouting in this room? What happened to being stealthy? I don't have too much more to say about the gameplay, to be honest, apart from one missed opportunity, when you find yourself at a locked door, which the Doctor gets through by inputting the birthday of one of the staff member's children. You learn that birthday by reading one of the files on a laptop in the neighbouring room, but the game doesn't ask for your agency in guessing the code. As long as you've read that file, the door will open for you. And as for the game's presentation, I mainly have just nitpicks, because it's a surprisingly good-looking game. Environments are distinct and atmospheric, there's a good amount of environmental detail despite the occasional graphical glitch. And also those cardboard Cybermen in the background. But you know what, I'm glad this game has recreated the special effects from the black and white days. Oh, and this, a funny delay.
Where are they going?
Fort Cecil, the only people for 100 miles. They'll convert them and move on.
Including you, Doctor.
Oh, sorry, I was a bit late on the response there. Could you give me my cue again?
Sorry, Doctor, it's Steve's first day as cyber leader and he's a bit nervous.
Jeff, I've got butterflies in my tummy.
Not in front of our mortal enemy, Steve.
Honestly, though, I don't have much to say here, which is good, well, for me at least, after so many lengthy back-to-back-to-back videos for the past 2.5 weeks. Blood of the Cybermen was a decent distraction to this marathon, and the Arctic base setting with vibes of John Carpenter's The Thing is a concept I would like to see the TV show maybe adapt and recreate. In its current form, though, it's a decent 45-minute distraction, and I think I've exhausted all I can say about it. There were plans for more adventure games after that positive reception, with City of the Daleks exceeding all expectations for the BBC and Sumo Digital by getting 500,000 downloads. However, after episode 5, The Gunpowder Plot, focus shifted onto the PlayStation 3 game, The Eternity Clock, which was meant to be the start of a brand new series of games that never materialized. In hindsight, it's a shame, because I would have liked to have seen more adventure games. They were pretty good distractions, but we have had more Doctor Who games in LEGO form, and even VR since then. In fact, during the editing process of this video, another one got announced called The Edge of Reality, which will feature the Cybermen, along with the Weeping Angels and the Daleks, facing the 10th and the 13th Doctors. But tomorrow on Cybercember, we return to the TV show for the epic 2-year-long saga of Craig Owens. Okay, we're doing that tomorrow, I guess.
I was not expecting this!